Hello folks, welcome back to the Ripedia world, and I am Abhinay Gupta, and today again we'll continue with the standards on auditing. Actually, we are going to continue with this topic for quite long now, right? This is a huge topic, the entire standards if we are talking about, and it also covers a huge portion of your entire audit syllabus, right? So we'll make an effort, we'll try and finish it up as quick as possible with as many videos as possible for you. Right, so that people who are also having their exams in May 2016 can refer to these videos. For November, this is the best time to start referring to these videos. Right, so in the previous lecture, we had already started with SA200. Right, and not only started, we had already completed discussing about the objectives and to some extent about the requirements of the standard. Right, you must be thinking that yes, I have taken some time on the just two requirements. You know why? Because in your examination, basically you don't have a direct question from this standard, SA200, right? But you may be asked a FOMA question to explain what is professional skepticism or what is professional judgment of an auditor. So you may get that kind of a question. So you need to remember all the points, right? You need to remember each and everything in it, because that is what will score you 4 marks. So imagine you have studied the topic, you have been through the professional skepticism, you have seen the lectures, you have studied it, still you're not able to score 4 out of 4 in the examination. What will happen? So for example, if you have all the questions for 4 marks in the examination and you score 2 and 3 on an average on all the answers, you're not able to score 4. If you score 3 in all the answers and you have all the answers right, even then you can score a maximum up to 75 marks. 25 marks goes for a toss because of no cause. And if you get 2 in some, it comes down to 60. And if you get an answer wrong, it comes to 50s line. And if you are not able to complete your paper, for example, if you leave 2 questions and you get 3 questions wrong, there's a risk of passing the examination. Risk of passing means actually there's a risk that you may also fail. So try and understand, it is not just about covering the syllabus and writing everything in your examination. No. When you are attempting your question, you have to be prepared to such an extent that you score 4 out of 4 in answers. For the easy topic, professional skepticism, now if you ask yourself, it is a very easy topic now. We have already in detail discussed about what is professional skepticism. So you should not be facing any problem with that if you are preparing your hand notes side by side. Right? If you write all this content, there's nobody who can give you less than 4. Because this is the exact content from the essay. But if you just go on writing some points, missing out some points or changing the words, the important words, you can obviously frame sentences in your own word, but the important keywords have to be there. Right? So when you're preparing for audit, prepare it with that intent. Because you have a lot of questions in audit, and 1 mark going in each question, that means the number of questions you have, that is the number of marks you lose. Right? So let us again not get into that discussion and cover up with the remaining 3 requirements. So to start with, if we give you a brief review of what requirements we have already discussed, then we have discussed the ethical requirement relating to an audit of financial statement. Right? And the basic ethics, you know, overall, which is pervasive, is the ethics of independence. Other than that, you have 5 other ethics, which is IOPCP. I'm not showing it on the screen today. I hope you remember it. It is IOPCP. Integrity, objectivity, professional competence and due care, confidentiality and professional behavior. These are the only 5 ethical requirements. Nothing more, nothing less. Right? Then we moved on to the next topic, which was professional skepticism. So in a layman's term, I hope now all of you are really able to relate to what is professional skepticism and understand that when we are talking about professional skepticism, what are we actually demanding from you, right? But when you need to write it in the examination, you have to use certain words. So you explain it that it is an attitude, right? It's an individual's attitude. An attitude that includes a questioning mind being alert to conditions which may indicate possible misstatement and critical assessment of audit evidences, right? So first of all, it is an attitude which gives you a questioning mind, right, which helps you to be alert on the conditions so that you get hold of that possible misstatement which is arising either due to fraud or misstatement or error, right? And so that you are also able to critically evaluate each audit statement that comes to you, right? For that, what you have to do, you have to plan and perform the audit with professional skepticism. What will it do? It would reduce the risk of overlooking the unusual circumstances. It would reduce the risk of overgeneralizing, right? You would go with specific thinking, specific topics, and inappropriate assumptions can be skipped. Inappropriate assumption that give you an inappropriate nature, time and extent, right? Now, what is the requirement of professional skepticism? That you need to be alert on what aspects? You need to be alert on those evidence that are contradictory to some other, right? You need to always be suspicious about the reliability of the documents that you are getting. You may be suspicious with those indications that indicate fraud, right? So these are the requirements of professional skepticism. And also pay attention to those circumstances which are not at par with the standards on auditing. There are some other circumstances, right? So you will have to check, what are they, why are they, what is the reason, what is the impact, what is the effect, right? So that is all that we have already discussed in the previous lecture. Today we'll move a step ahead. Today we'll see what is professional judgment, right? It's a very small term. You understand that, okay, when we are talking about professional judgment, we are talking about the judgment we make as a chartered accountant, right? Okay, you understand that, but you need to connect to that, and you need to know the words, you need to know the keywords that you need to write in your examination. So basically, all of you have been exposed to your trainings in your internship. I assume that you are going for an internship, right? And all of you are also exposed to the text that you are reading, the standards that you are reading, the lectures that you are viewing, the accounts, law, direct tax, indirect tax, costing, SFM, all the things that you have studied, right? You have knowledge about those things. You have been getting the trainings, right? Various training programs of the institute, trainings in your office. You're getting the practical experience, exposure on the client, right? These things are actually building up a professional in you. If you see in CA, what all things you get, these are the specific things that you get. This is what makes a chartered accountant. Without your training, you cannot complete your CA. Without studying, you cannot pass your CA. Right? Without your internship, you cannot. You cannot be eligible to give your final exam. So the main focus for the institute behind this was to enable you to be a professional in the market. Right? And when you have these skills and when you have been equipped with these things, you are eligible, you are able to make professional judgment. Now, what is professional judgment? These are the judgments that you make into your profession. What is your profession? Your profession is a profession of a chartered accountant. Auditing, taxation, assurance. This is your profession. So while you are auditing, you have to make a professional judgment at a lot of places. It is not a fixed rule-based process, right? What judgment you have to make? So for example, whenever you're getting samples, you have to make judgment. Of how, when you are getting the data, how do you evaluate the samples? What will be the nature, time and extent of the audit? What would be the materiality at this client? What is the risk? What are the items, what is the materiality level below which, okay, we are risk free? Right? You should be able to evaluate, you should be able to read and understand the financials, the circumstances, the management judgment, the letters that the letter of representation that the management gave, you should be able to evaluate those. You should take decision, right? You should be able to seek alternatives, the better alternatives, right? Where do you apply professional judgment? When you need to understand what are the procedures that you will apply to get to a conclusion. Where to apply those procedures, right? What is the impact? Where will you lay more stress? Where will you not lay more stress? What is the risk? Where you don't have risk? These are the things that will require your professional judgment to be applied. Right? So are you being able to connect with what professional judgment is and what is the difference between professional judgment and professional skepticism? So professional judgment is a wider term. It is pervasive throughout the audit, from the day one, from accepting the engagement till the end day, till the date you are signing the audit report. Everywhere you use professional judgment. But professional skepticism is specific. Professional skepticism is always applied with an intent to reduce risk. Right? When you're getting evidences in evaluation, you apply professional skepticism. When you're getting data, when you're getting representations for evaluation, you apply professional skepticism with a questioning attitude. Is it right? Is it wrong? What else could go wrong? These are the things. But in professional judgment, even if there is no risk, but you have to apply some procedures, you have to complete the audit. So for that, you apply professional judgment. Right? The entire procedure, what to go ahead with, who are the audit team members? How do you construct and build a team? Even that is a professional judgment. Which clients to take, which clients not to accept, that is a professional judgment. What should be the time frame for completing this audit? That is a professional judgment. Right? So everywhere, when you are doing your audit, you are being prepared as a professional and you are required to apply a judgment while doing your work. It is not all rule based. That yeah, if the company is beyond this limit, accept it. Below this limit, reject it. This field accept, that field reject. No, you don't have anything like that. It is on you. You have to apply a professional judgment and decide. Right? So that is professional judgment. So now if you are able to link with it, we would now go to the text. Right? So as per the definition, as per your standards, as per your study material, right, and everywhere, the meaning of professional judgment is the application of relevant training, knowledge and experience that I've already talked about. The trainings that you have received from the institute, the GMCS training, the orientation programming, ITT training and stuff, right? The knowledge that you are gaining in your IPCC in your final from the various subjects and the experience that you are gaining during your internship, your articleship. Right? So you'll apply these relevant training, knowledge and experience that you have got within the context, right, which is provided by the auditing and accounting and ethical standard. So these trainings of yours, these knowledge, these experience, they are all bounded by the standards that the institute has prepared. So you will not go beyond the standard. If standard says you have to do this, you have to apply your brain, apply your skill within that boundary area itself. Right? So what do you do by applying them? You apply them. Where do you apply them? You apply them in making informed decisions about the course of action that are appropriate in the circumstance of audit engagement. Right? That is professional judgment. Making a judgment under the restriction of the standards, within the boundary of the standards. Right? Now what are the requirements? Professional judgment is individually a topic. That was the objective. Now what is the requirement of professional judgment? Right? So an auditor is required to use his professional judgment, right, when he is planning and performing an audit. Planning would also include from the day one when you are accepting the client. You are planning. This client or this client? Whom will I take? This manager or this manager? This accountant or that accountant? Right? How do I go about? What do I start? Which location do I go first? Right? Do I need to do the inventory check? These are all your planning. So you have to apply your judgment while you are planning and performing the audit. And this has to be applied throughout. From the initiation till the end. Right? And it will depend on the facts and the circumstance which you already know. If there is a company and you're deciding whether or not to accept it, how will you decide it? You will not say, oh, I think the CEO is a good person. I would want to help him. Oh, this industry is good. I would want to work with a client in this industry. No, that is not all. That is not it. Right? You will have the various facts about the industry, about that company. Right? You will see your circumstance, whether or not you are in a position to accept an audit, whether you have sufficient available team for that. Are you or aren't you overburdening your team? Will you be able to perform it? Will you be able to do justice with it? That is where you apply professional judgment. Right? So it is very important when you are deciding basically the materiality and the audit risk, when you're determining the nature, time and extent of the audit procedure that you're applying. So what procedures are applying, how much, to what extent you're applying, when are you applying, where are you applying, what are the sample size, all of these. Right? And then you will also evaluate the sufficiency and appropriateness of the audit procedures. To what extent would you extend? What will be the size of the audit sample? Right? You will evaluate the management's judgment in applying the applicable FRF. For example, Ind AS has become applicable now. right? It is optional to everybody and mandatory to the companies who have a net worth of more than 5 crores. It has already been applicable. So for them it is mandatory, but for them who is optional and management says we want to apply Ind AS, you will see whether or not management is actually being reasonable when they say we want to apply Ind AS. Whether their judgment behind accepting a new financial reporting framework is viable. You will have to check that. You will have to apply your professional judgment and you'll say, no, there are a hell lot of requirements, new requirements that have come up in Ind AS. You need some time to build up yourself for that. Right? So that is why they have been made applicable to very huge companies only. Don't get into the pit. Continue following your AS. If you have an option, start following it somewhere else, some year later. Prepare yourself for that. Know what it is. Prepare your employees for that. Not everybody is informed about Ind AS. Right? That is what you have to see. Right? And then drawing your conclusions based on the audit evidences. You have certain evidences and you'll say, okay, these are the evidences available for me. For the debtors, you have the debtor confirmation, you have the listing from the client, you have their aging, you have everything. And then you will have to decide whether or not you have to make some provisions. What is happening? They are not being able to pay debts. I think provision is required. There may be a bad debt. So these are the kinds of decisions that you take by applying your professional judgment. Right? Okay. Next, the sufficient appropriate audit evidence and audit risk. So first of all, what is sufficient and what is appropriate? You need to understand the difference. The sufficient basically is the quantity. Right? What is the quantity? For example, in a sampling, right? How much samples will you pick up that will be sufficient to analyze, that will be sufficient to actually talk for or speak for the rest of the population? I have a dump of 10,000 line items. Will 25 line items be enough to judge the rest? You will have to analyze. Right? You will have to analyze what is the quantity. And then also the quality. Now, in the same case, right, now consider, you have a dump for example, business promotion expenses, right? You have a dump of 10,000 line items. And now you have to do your sampling. Forget about feeding it to IDEA, right? We are not giving it to IDEA right now. You still have to apply sampling. You don't have the software. Right, so now you will have to sanitize the entire dump, you will have to segregate, you will have to see what are the high item values, what are the negative item values, what are contradictory evidences, right, what are contra entries that has to be closed, right, what are of specific nature. If there is any particular expenditure that is occurring over and over again, that means you have made a lot of investment in that field. So you also draw a pivot table for that and then you analyze with your pivot table. Okay, you prepare various graphs and see what is happening and then you come out with a conclusion. Yes, this is a sample I will take. Right? That is the basic procedure that even we follow in the Big Fours. Right? So you have to analyze the entire dump. So after analyzing, you think, okay, these are the few very high value items and unusual. Let me pick them up. What are they? Right? These are some unique expenses they have made. Let me pick up. What are they? Right? These are expenses that are of repetitive nature. Although small amounts, but they are of very repetitive nature. And I am doubtful whether or not they are actually incurring such an expenditure. Whether is that kind of an expenditure required for business promotion, I will pick them up. Right? You are applying your professional judgment over there. But when I am talking about these specific samples, right, they are appropriate. They are relevant samples. They will give me some idea behind the scene, what is happening. There are many expenses that I have just incurred by a name of certain employee. That yes, I have given it to him and he has expended it. What is that kind of an entry being made in the dump? Suspicious, right? So I'll pick up an entry from there. That is appropriate. Right? Now, if I pick up 4 appropriate samples, will that be enough for the entire dump? No. Again, I'll have to see. Okay, these samples that I have picked up, individually they are all appropriate. But in totality, are they sufficient to draw a conclusion? Are 4 samples enough to draw a conclusion? No, I would require more of such appropriate evidences to samples to draw a conclusion. then maybe I decide to take up 25 or 50 samples, or even more than that if required. So what is sufficient would depend on the appropriateness. If you get very, very appropriate samples, then you would be satisfied with a lower volume. But if you don't get very appropriate samples, you will have to increase your volume. Alternatively, if you are already working on a large volume, right? So for example, you have your legal expenses, right? All of you who are doing your audit, you know that legal expenses are very critical area. You generally do not give it to the software for sampling. You judge each one of them, right? You know what is the basic purpose of sampling and judging the entire legal head? The legal expenditure is the favorite thing for an auditor. Why? Because there you find a business opportunity. You see that, okay, these are the legal expenses they are incurring. And some of these can be done by us. Why are they hiring somebody else? Then you go to the management. Yeah, we can provide you the service. Why are you going for it to somebody else? It will not be an independent issue with us also. So that is another reason why legal and professional expenses are very interesting topic for us. But otherwise also, you may have to scrutinize through all the legal expenditures, because you have to see whether or not there is any litigation with the company. Is the company working well? What are the cases with the company? Are they doing good with the other professionals who are providing them certain services? Right? If they are building up a factory, if they are building a factory building, then they have hired an engineer. Are they satisfied with their services? What is the engineer doing? Right? These things you have to check. So over there, if you are checking for, so generally for legal, you're checking the entire dump. So when you're checking the entire dump, it is sufficient, it is wholly sufficient. Then you don't need to check the appropriateness, because they're not leaving anything. Right? So basically, sufficiency and appropriateness are inversely proportional. If it is too sufficient, less of appropriateness would work. But if it is less sufficient, you would have to have high appropriate samples to draw a conclusion. Right? So I hope this example will help you to understand what is sufficiency and what is appropriateness of audit evidences. Right? So that is what the fourth topic all talks about. The sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidences. Right? So the requirement to obtain a reasonable assurance is that you have to obtain a sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. Why? For to reduce the audit risk. Right? What is audit risk? We'll discuss it later. Earlier you used to have, like, if you, let me give you a brief about it. When you talked about it in your IPCC, that yeah, we have inherent risk, control risk, detection risk, but now all those risks are actually audit risk, right? And they are divided into ROMM and detection risk. So inherent risk and control risk are under ROMM, R-O-M-M, risk of material misstatement. It is an abbreviation used widely. Even in Big Four, we use that abbreviation ROMM. So you can write ROMM in your examination, there is no problem with that, right? So what is reasonable assurance? It is high but not absolute assurance. Right? What is sufficient appropriate audit evidences? We have already discussed this. So when you're writing in the examination, you would frame a better word for that. So you will say sufficiency refers to the quantum and appropriateness refers to the quality. So quantity and quality also you can write. Quantum is a better word that is given by your standard itself. Right? An audit risk is the risk that the auditor would express an inappropriate audit opinion when the financial statements are materially misstated. Right? So that is all about the fourth point, sufficient appropriate audit evidence and audit risk. Now we move on to the last point. This will take some time for us. That is the conduct of an audit in accordance with SAs. So let us see this topic in the next slide. So we have the conduct of audit in accordance with SAs. There are four basic subparts. So what it says actually, number one, compliance with relevant SAs. When we talk about compliance with relevant SAs, what do you mean? This word relevant is very important, right? So the auditor would check whether or not the management is complying with all the SAs that are relevant for the specific company, right? So for example, if the company is not preparing comparative information, then SA 710 is not required in this company. right? If they're not using the word of using the work of an expert, then SA620 is not required. If they're not using the work of other auditor or internal auditor, SA600 and SA610 is not required, right? So all the relevant SAs which are required to be applied by that company, that they have to be applied, they have to be complied with. That is the purpose of this point, compliance with the relevant SAs, right? So when we're talking about conducting an audit in accordance with the standards on auditing, we're talking about only those standards on auditing that are applicable to that company, right? Next is objectives stated in individual SAs, right? So you have an objective while you are performing your audit, that you have to give an opinion, a fair opinion, right? But that overall objective can't be reached unless and until you break it down into smaller objectives and meet them. So the overall objective is actually your goal, but for that you need to have smaller milestones, right? So for that milestones, you would prefer the milestones of each essay. So if there are certain essays which are applicable on the companies, and those essays have their individual objectives, right? When we are starting an essay, we are always discussing about its objective. So if you try and meet out all the objectives of various essays, on the whole, ultimately your final objective is met, right? So if you want to achieve your final objective, achieve all the objectives of the essays, right? Next is complying with relevant requirements. Now, okay, we are actually talking about on the large conduct of an audit in accordance with SAs. Now, what do we mean by complying with relevant requirements? Are we going beyond SA? No. Try and understand. There may be a situation when the entire standard is not applicable on a company, but a part of it is applicable. In that situation, it says that you will have to comply with that relevant requirement, that small part from the entire SA. So it is not just necessary that you comply with the relevant essay, that means only the essay that are completely applicable. But if there is an essay whose smaller part, just a small part is applicable, you will have to comply with the provisions of that essay as well. Now I'll give you an example for that. So there is an essay in your 500 series. When you come to that, you will understand. Right, we'll deal with that in detail. But now I need to give you a reference to that essay. Essay 501. Which is audit evidences and specific consideration for selected items. So over there, that entire essay is actually broken into three parts. Or to say, they basically deal with three different kinds of objectives, right? It deals with inventories, right? They need to see, they need to judge its existence and conclusion. They deal with litigations and claims. They need to see, judge about its completeness. Right, and they also deal with segment information, presentation and disclosure, right, according to the applicable FRS. So if your company, if you do not have any segment reporting, right, or if you do not actually go ahead with inventory, you are a service provider industry, you don't have inventories, but litigation and claims are one thing that you need to check. So for that you will apply that essay, but you are not applying the entire essay. Right? That is what this point means to say, that you are complying with the relevant requirements of the particular individual essay. Right? So this is how you actually comply with the entire essay. Conduct of an audit in accordance with essay, that means first of all select those essays which are relevant, meet their objective so that you meet the overall objective, right? And if there are essays that are not completely applicable, apply the portion which is relevant. Right? And the final is the failure to achieve an objective, which means to say, if you are not able to achieve any objective of the standard, then what is the reason? Either it is your incompetency, or there is something going wrong with the management, with the company, right? So we always fail to understand that it is our incompetency, because we are not incompetent, right? So what is going wrong actually? Something is going wrong with the management, something is going wrong with the company. You are not able to apply your essay, or the objectives of the essays fail. If that is happening, then you cannot give a clean report. Right? Your report would be qualified with that specific point. So that is the totality of conduct of an audit in accordance with SA. And that is the entire requirement. Ethical requirements relating to the audit of financial statement. Professional skepticism, professional judgment,
sufficient appropriate audit evidence and audit risk, and conduct of an audit in accordance with FPA. Now I think you will not forget these five requirements. Right? You know the details of them, you have connected to them, and you have understood each and every word from the FPA. Right? If anyone still has a query, you can post it down in the comment. And if you're liking it, and if there is something specific you want me to come up with in the upcoming lectures, right? Or if there's something you want me to continue in other lectures as well, please feel free to comment on the box below. Right? So that is all about the requirement. And we'll pick up the next topic or the next part of this essay, that is the application material, in the next lecture. Right? So until then, please go through these requirements. Right? Go through whatever text you're having or follow the institute study material. That is the best thing to follow. And then prepare your handwritten notes. Right? Because when you read through the text, you have heard it, you have felt it, now read it, and that will seep in. And then we'll move on with the next topic in the next lecture. So until then, stay tuned. This is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Thank you.